Shirin Laor-Raz Salemnia, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. This is awesome. I'm glad you started it.
As I told you earlier, I like to pick my backgrounds for the guest, and you are a gamer extraordinaire. So I went back to the thing that I enjoyed the most. I used to play Mario Kart with my two daughters. So this just brings me back. So
yeah, that's awesome. I think that's what I commented on when I first got on. I was like, that's cool. That's my jam, Super Mario Brothers.
Yeah. So can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you got into gaming and what it is you do?
Sure. So this goes back to the 80s, and a couple things were pivotal for me, even though I was super young. The first thing is I had a female computer science teacher. I went to public school here in LA. I went to a school in Westwood called Fairburn Avenue School. And again, I had a female computer science teacher and she taught us how to code. And we had computer science every single day. And we had an Apple IIc green screen computer and we played Carmen Sandiego and we learned how to code Fortran. So that was like game changing for me. That was like a first clue. And then, at home, I was playing Atari and Nintendo, so hence Super Mario. But Atari 2600, so like I was obsessed with Paperboy and like Pac-Man, I'm the champion for Pac-Man. So all those things. And then I saw the movie Big with Tom Hanks and it changed my life. I was like, whoa, this guy gets to test toys and he gets paid for it like all day long. That's so cool. I want that job. But even though I was like super techie and really into you know, tech, I decided that was going to be it. So throughout my life, I would go around telling people, this is what I want to do. And people would be like, wait, you don't want to be a doctor or a lawyer? What do you mean? Like, come on, like, you should be a doctor or a lawyer. I'm like, no. I want to test toys, just like Tom Hanks, the movie Big. So I got a lot of resistance, which was really fun. But I guess if you know me, when I get resistance, I want to do something more. So that's, it fuels the fire. So that's how it started. So I went off to Cal State Northridge and majored in child psychology. Even though I was still like techie and my brother, like, and he was actually one of the first beta testers for World of Warcraft. So I watch him and it was interesting. So I went to Cal State Northridge, majored in child psych, went to the Career Center and they were like, what do you want to do? Like usually child psych majors come back and get a master's or a PhD or work in a school or a hospital. What do you mean? What do you want to do? And I said, this is what I want. And at the time there was no Google. So again, I'm aging myself, but so I used to go to the library and look up books and look up like majors and connect the dots. And there was, you know, a book for careers that said child psych major, toy tester career. And I took it to the Career Center. I said, look at this, look what I have here. And they're like, what? We've never heard of it. So they were trying to make me, you know, go left. And I was like, no, I'm going my way. Like, so I ended up, they were like, okay, fill out this Myers-Briggs form, please. I'm like, fine. So I filled it out. And ironically, I went back the next day and they were like, there's a huge discrepancy between what you're telling us and what, you know, came out in this Myers-Briggs. And I said, you know what? I don't care what anybody says. This is what I really want to do. And they're like, no, please hear us out. So there was like big block letters on this post-it note. And it said, you know, huge discrepancy. I'm like, okay. So they're like, move to the last page. I'm like, okay. And it said, there was two things that I was meant to do. And again, this is like, I'm just about to graduate from college. So guess what these two things were?
Gaming and teaching?
No, but you're close. So business and technology. And I just threw it out. I was like, yeah, this is bullshit. No, that's not what I want. But so when I look back at my life, it's like all of these things were clues and signs and messages. But at the time I was like, no, I call it being on the tech yellow brick road. I'm literally on the tech yellow brick road. And when I had to move a couple years ago, I found this Myers-Briggs and I was like, holy shit, this is so creepy. I totally forgot about it. But then when I started Playworks and all these things, I was like, this is, wow, okay, this is a sign. Okay, thanks, universe, for the message.
Did you go back and learn a little bit about Myers-Briggs or?
No, not really. But I had one professor at CSUN, and I still keep in touch with him now. That was like my champion. He was like, you can do this. We're going to make this happen. And everybody else was like, you're nuts. You don't know what you're talking about. That's not a career. Is that a real job? Like, I heard all the fun things. Yeah.
Well, the funny thing is I have a good friend who's very into the Myers-Briggs. And one thing she told me is there are rare people that they either call them, like, depending on the test, the Twin Towers, or like they're good in separate areas. And if those people find the right, you know, the right fit for them, they just have amazing success in their careers because they're good at two things that most people aren't good at. So it doesn't surprise me. I mean, I guess you could be good at two things that, you know, I always think, like, what would it be like if Albert Einstein was born 1,000 years earlier, you know, and doesn't have the basis to be able to build what he could build, but you're living in the right time. So sounds like you found your calling.
Yeah. So that was a big clue. And again, I didn't remember anything until I had to move, and it was like, whoa, this is creepy. And okay. Wow. Okay. So I end up, going to like job fairs and career fairs and really trying to get into Mattel, because there was only two places I could go, either Mattel or Hasbro. And since Mattel was in LA, I was like, okay, I'm gonna stick here. I don't want to go to Hasbro. That's in Rhode Island. So I did, again, no Google, no meetups, nothing. I'm doing like process of elimination through books in the library, or like post-its on the boards in the library, like that kind of thing. And I found out there was a toy association in LA, and there was a women in toys group, and there was a toy fair in New York, and all these different things. And then I, meanwhile, sent a resume to Mattel, and I got a postcard in the mail, which was really funny. I was like, I don't want a postcard. I want a job. Like, come on, people. So I ended up going to this toy or job fair at UCLA, and this recruiting group was like, come to our office. So I met with like six of them, and I met with the owner of the recruiting firm in Manhattan Beach, which is like 5 minutes from Mattel. And she had me sit down. She was the owner, and the first thing she says to me is, oh, college students to graduate, they don't know their right hand from their left hand. And I was like, wait, what? Like, I'm telling you exactly what I want. I know there's a lot of people that don't know what they want, but I'm telling you, I want to be a toy tester. I've done my research. Mattel and Hasbro are the only companies that have, you know, market research departments. And she was like, no, you don't know what you're talking about. And by the way, it's not a good time to be at Mattel right now. It was a great toy company. It's right on PCH, on the way to Malibu. It's gorgeous, right across from the beach. And they have an opening. And I said, okay, what is it? I'd never heard of it. And she said, yeah, it's called Jack's Pacific. And I said, oh, that's interesting. Do they have a research department? And she said, no. And I was like, wait, what? So hold on. What am I going to do there? And she's like, oh, it's a customer service job. You just got to get your foot in the door. I was like, no. She pissed me off so bad. I actually drove to Mattel on my way back. Walked in, and the security guard was like, can I help you? And I said, yeah, can you get me someone in the HR department? And he's like, do you have an appointment? And I said, no. And he said, then I can't help you. And I said, what? He's like, are you looking for a job? And I said, yeah. He's like, call our job hotline. I said, look, I already got a freaking postcard when I sent in my resume. I just want to talk to someone live to see what kind of openings are, or how do I get a job here? And we went back and forth for like 10 minutes. He said, sorry, ma'am, I can't help you. This is a high security building. And I said, okay, fine. You know what? When I get a job here, you're going to be like, there's that crazy girl that wouldn't leave me alone that day. He just looked at me and he smirked. And I was like, uh-huh, you'll remember. Okay, bye. So I walked back to the car, and I was like, okay, I got to figure this out. This is like when I need to do something, it's like I find a way. Like when there's a will, there's a way, right? So I ended up finding out there's a toy design program at Otis, which is a school in Westchester right by Mattel. And at the time, they had, I think it was like a few years into their program.
It's a good design school.
It's an amazing school.
Came out of there. Yeah.
Yeah. So I ended up calling up the chairman of the program, and he said, come to my office. So we met, and I said, here's my issue. I love design. I'm super creative. This sounds like an amazing program. Do you guys have a master's? Because I just graduated with a bachelor's. And he said, no. And I was like, what do you recommend? Because I really want to be like Tom Hanks, the movie Big. And like, I feel like I need to find a way to make this happen. And he looked at me and said, you know what? Why don't you call my friend? He's the head of research. Ask him for an informational interview and take him to lunch. People love to talk about themselves. And you never know. I was like, oh, okay, cool, thanks. So I go home the next day. I call his friend, head of research. He actually picks up the phone. His assistant did it, which was like a miracle. And I said, our mutual friend, the head of, you know, design at Otis, said I should call you and take you to lunch because I'd love to hear about your job. And he was like, oh, yeah, he's great. Da, da, da. He went up, you know, off about how wonderful he was. And I said, yeah, he's great, dude. I mean, I wasn't like, hey, he gave me the golden ticket, but like, okay, cool, thanks. So I basically said, so when are you available? And he's like, oh, well, I don't have time for lunch, but why don't you just come over? I was like, okay, cool. So we set up a time. I drive to Mattel and I walk in. I'm like, this is awesome. I'm getting a job. I can feel it. This is going to be amazing. So I walk into his office and it's filled with toys. And I was like, this is a dream come true. I'm in. Like, it was a corner office. It was everything. It was like very cool. So I walk in, give him my business card, and he looks at me and he says, are you an entrepreneur? And I said, what? No. And he says, you just hand me a business card with a link to your resume on it. That's pretty innovative. I think you're an entrepreneur. And I just kind of like looked at him like, okay, interesting. So that was another clue, right? So all these times I've had all of these clues about what my journey is on the tech yellow brick road. And that's why I'm writing a book about it. But so we sat down and chatted for like an hour. And at the end, I asked him for a job. And he said, unfortunately, we don't have any positions right now, but I'll keep you posted. And I told him that I was going to go to the toy fair in New York on my own. And he was like, wow, nobody's ever gone to the toy fair on their own. Like, people that even work for me don't even go to toy fair. I was like, oh, interesting. So we had a little chat. And then we kept in touch for 9 months. I sent him letters and thank you cards and like baskets for the holiday. I was like in his face like for 9 months. And then I went off to the toy fair, and he had me like a few days before I went up to New York, meet with his team. And I was like, okay, this is a good sign, because he's having me meet his, you know, entire team. This is pretty cool. So, and then like, I don't know, maybe 8 out of 10 of them were like, we've never been to toy fair. We don't even want to be here. We want to be in the music industry or movies or whatever. And I was like, wait, you're keeping me from my dream job. Hello, people, come on. Like, so that's how it started. So I went to New York, ended up staying for a month, and then got stuck in a snowstorm. But he called and he was like, how's it going? How is the toy fair? Did you get a job? Ha ha ha. I'm like, no. He's like, I told you weren't going to get a job there. Like, he's like, but I really thought about you and your persistence and passion and grit, and I created a position for you. So can you come to work on Thursday? And I was like, there's no flights to LA. That's my luck. He's like, don't worry about it. Just come to work when you get back to LA safely. I'm like, okay, good. Thank you. That's how it started. So yeah, I was at Mattel for 3 years. Dream come true. It was like amazing. That was my, start of live MBA school. And then I went to, this is a crazy story actually. So the day I decided to quit my job at Mattel, I used to go to the gym in Century City, which was a Bodies in Motion. And the craziest thing is I had a guy walk in at the front door when I was like, I'm done. I told all my people that I work with by my cubicles, I'm like, I'm not coming to work anymore. I'm done. Like, this sucks. They're keeping me in a box. They know I'm like passionate and gung-ho and da 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 da. And yeah, so guess who walked in the door at the gym?
I don't know.
So I'm wrapping my hands because I'm about to go kickboxing, and I'm like ready to kill someone, literally. And like the kid that played in the movie Big walks in the door.
Oh, you're kidding.
No.
Wow. Can you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Okay. We just had a little technical difficulty.
Okay. So which part did you not hear?
I heard the kid who played in Big.
That was okay. So the receptionist was like, I'm here every single day, and I've seen this guy every single day. I'm like, I'm here almost every day. I've never seen this guy. The day I decided to quit my job, he's like, shows up, right? So I walk up to him and I said, Josh, wait, what's your name? He's like, David. I'm like, do you know what you made me do? I was so pissed that day. I was like, I'm done. Like, I can't be kept in a box. This is not fair. And he looked at me and said, is that a real job? I'm like, oh my God, I've been doing it for 3 years. Come on. Like, it's a real job. Come on. He's like, well, I'm an actor. I didn't know. Like, come on. So for the next like hour and a half, he's persuaded to tell me that I can't quit my job. And I was like, come on, you don't understand. They're keeping me in a box. I ended up not going kickboxing. And I went back. So that was a Friday afternoon. I went back to work on Monday morning and everyone was like, wait, what are you doing here? And I said, you guys will never believe who I ran into at the gym on Friday. It's wild. And we're actually friends on Facebook.
I was going to guess Muhammad Ali, but no, that's totally wrong.
No. So I'm telling you, there's all these signs and messages and clues on my tech yellow brick road ever since day one. Yeah. It's wild.
Wow. So how much longer did you stay after that?
I ended up staying like 6 months longer because I guess I had to finish something or I don't know, the timing wasn't right. And then I ended up going to MGA and starting the research department from scratch. And then within 6 months being the brand manager for Bratz. So that was like serious live MBA school.
Yeah. Well, just listening to your story, you know, what you have more than anything else is gumption. And you need a lot of that as an entrepreneur.
Well, I think I never thought of myself as an entrepreneur up until like I remember now vividly when he kept saying you're an entrepreneur, you know, the first day that we met. And I was like, I thought it was really cool and different. Like I like being cool and different and outside the box. I didn't know that means you're an entrepreneur, but okay, cool. Like, so I never really thought about that, but I guess it was all, you know, meant to be.
Oh, totally. I mean, I was an executive in the music industry for a while and you know, we had the same kind of thing. There were some people who they wanted to be a Mattel, you know. We had people who loved music and we had others that, no, they just, you know, this is a job. And I'm like, why would you get a job at a music company? Like there are people that would give their, you know, right arm to be at the music company. Go do your passions. And then
right. There
would be people, but not exactly like your story, but there would be people who'd be like, I got to work here. And you'd have people that would intern, they would do anything, they pack CDs, they go to shows, they do anything. And the initiative really makes a difference because you're going to be better at it when you're passionate at it.
Right.
I imagine that, you know, whatever you did, you cared more than just the job. You wanted to do great. You wanted to build great toys, right?
Right.
You wanted to build something. It's been a long time since I saw Big, but the whole conceit of it was the Tom Hanks character goes, this is no fun to play. Why do you want to play?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so I would test toys with the kids and figure out what works and what doesn't work and really listen to them. But then when it got through, you know, corporate and all that stuff, it became not what the kids wanted. And I was like, did we not listen to what the kids wanted? Hello, people, come on. Like, super important.
Well, as a kid, I remember when that started, like there were these soulless toys and the whole, you know, they're like very wooden. And the whole point of them is that they've got to tie in with a Saturday morning show or they got to tie in with something else. And
yeah.
And so it's so important to have passion in what you do.
I agree.
Yeah. So how did you go from, you know, building those kind of toys to gamers, to games?
So the biggest thing I found when I worked on Bratz towards the end was now YouTube has come out, right? It's 2005 and YouTube's come out and like, all of a sudden, we don't have apps yet, but we have like virtual worlds, right? So Neopets and like Club Penguin and like Disney's buying Club Penguin for like, you know,
Club Penguin.
Like an arm and a leg, right? I mean, they got half, I think it was like 350 million, but they didn't hit the milestone. So they just got half or something like that.
Yeah.
So I started seeing a shift in like, you know, numbers going down on actual dolls flying off shelves or whatever to actual like things going online. So we do a virtual world. And then I start listening to parents, like, really not happy about how, you know, the toys are for their kids. And they keep saying they're not positive role models and we need positive role models. And I'm like scratching my head, like, look, I got the corner office. I got the toys. I got everything I ever wanted. Now I'm like, I don't know about this anymore because I feel like I'm contributing negatively and parents aren't, you know, or even in social settings, not even at work, like in focus group, not just focus groups, but like I hear it all the time. So that's when my existential crisis hit. So I was getting sick all the time, hated going to work, even though I had the dream job and then some. I was like questioning my existence on the planet in my late 20s. I was like doing raw food and life coaching and trying all these different things and trying to figure out what I'm supposed to do next. And the sequence of events, which is a super long story, but kind of like Eat, Pray, Love, if you know that book mm-hmm. and movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. It started with, so in 2005, I I guess it wasn't an accident because there's no accidents, but I was picked up from the airport by my mom, and she took me to this event where Deepak Chopra was speaking. I didn't know who he was at the time because I was still in my like existential crisis of searching, but he did his talk and I ran up to him after and I said, I have like a $1 million question. He laughed at me and he said, what is it? And I said, well, what do you do when you get your dream? Because I don't know what to do with myself. And he was like, well, you have to give back. And I was like, I don't understand. Like, I volunteer my time. I give money to charity. I do all that stuff. What do you mean? He's like, no, trust me, you'll figure it out. I was like, can you tell me, give back to who, what, where, like another word, please? He was like, no, trust me, you'll figure it out. I was like, come on, don't leave me hanging. Just another word, please. He's like, no, trust me, you'll figure it out. So that was the first clue again. So give back. And then I got, now it's like 2006, a year later, and like we're starting this like Silicon Beach thing here in LA. It's like the little, like, I think it was like the first event that co-lofted with Simon Sinek. And I had some friends that were the head of EO. So they invited me and there was only like 30 people. So now Simon Sinek has his book called Start With Why. And I ran up to him, asked him the same question. He looked at me and he said, what's your purpose and why? I'm like, why is everybody giving me like a dangling clue, but not like a, hey, what's your passion? Go do X, Y, Z, whatever that is. Like,
tell me what to do.
Right. So now I have, so I was like, literally, you know how Steve Jobs says in the commencement speech, like I'm connecting the dots in hindsight. I was going for, I was like, okay, I got give back. I got, what's my purpose and why? Like the next messages were coming from the craziest places, which I won't get into because it's going to be a super long story. But the messages were, you got to create toys for kids. I heard this from a random kid person on the street, literally like, she was like, you got to make educational toys. I was like, okay, another clue. Then the next person was like doing TV for kids. And like, I was like, wait, maybe I should get into entertainment. That's a big media message. And at the time, Gina Davis had started her Gender and Media Institute. So I went to that and there was a lot of messages there. We needed more positive role models for girls in the space. And then the next big clue came where I decided, okay, I'm gonna quit my job officially. And now I have to go on my own and I'm gonna be a consultant now. So I'm going to the toy fair now on my own. This is like 2009. I went to Toy Fair on my own. And at this point, now I think Club Penguin had just sold to Disney. So they had Toy Fair. I don't know if you've been to New York. The Javits Center is massive, right? Like three floors of like football field style. There was a little section on the side, which was the size of like, I don't know, like a coffee shop with like 12 booths and like a little stage for the founder of Club Penguin, Lane. Right. He was speaking. So this little section was called Digital Kids. And so I'm walking around and like, okay, this is interesting. Okay, everything is like virtual worlds, Neopets, like all these games for kids. Like, okay, this is interesting. And every single booth there was like, oh, you should go to the Game Developers Conference, GDC in San Francisco in 2 weeks. And I'm like, what? Really? Okay. So I'm like following, you know, and then I had this chat with Lane, which was the founder of Club Penguin. And I asked him, like, what did you plan on doing? And he's like, well, I did this for my kids. I'm a web dude. Like, I wasn't planning to make a brand and all these things out of it. And I just like thought, oh my God, like coming with my background, like that's kids brands. It's brands. Like, you know, there's licensing and merchandising and all these things. Like, there's not just one little thing. So those were the next clues. It's
like a Reese's Pieces moment, right?
Yeah, exactly. So again, connecting the dots going forward, not backwards. So I'm like, okay, so 2 weeks later, I'm at GDC in San Francisco. And the first person I run into is my best friend's ex-boyfriend. And he's like, what are you doing here? And I'm like, what are you doing here? And he's like, I work at EA. I'm in mobile now. We're making mobile games. He used to work at Mattel in games. So he was my best friend's ex-boyfriend, but he also was in gaming at Mattel when I was there.
Right.
So I looked at him and I said, look, I'm thinking of starting a gaming company for girls. And he looked at me, he's like, you're nuts. I won't go there. I was like, what? What do you mean? He's like, no, trust me. So we had a chat and I said, look, you know me, if I want to do something, I'm going to make it happen. Like, don't give me this, no, the industry's not going to buy, blah, 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 whatever, all this bullshit. So I ended up having an amazing blast at GDC that year. It was insane. Like I met a million people. Like I met he was known as the mayor of GDC. He took me and introduced me to everyone. Like I went to this Microsoft event where I got a free pass to meet some people through USC. And that's how I got connected to USC. Like it was just like it was like the golden ticket of like following the yellow brick road, literally. Yeah, so that's how it started. So that's how I started Playworks. And we've been in beta ever since. Don't ask me what version it is. It's been an interesting journey of starting a gaming company and an interactive company in this day and age.
Yeah. So the book you're writing, is it about this journey?
Yeah, it's about my story.
Because I can see this being a movie.
Oh yeah, we've already had it. So it's funny because I have friends that are like been messing with me of who should play me. And I'm like, well, everyone says I look like Penelope Cruz. And I'm like, no. And then so let's fast forward, 2011, I got invited to do this masterclass with the JFED and it was Entertainment Council. So it was their 100-year anniversary and their 13-year bar mitzvah. So it was like the golden ticket of golden tickets. So let me back up. In 2009, I was in Israel for my cousin's wedding and some people were doing the masterclass there and they kept telling me about it. And I was like, I don't know what this masterclass is. I'm in the gaming industry. I don't know. I don't do that. Like, I don't do entertainment. Like, I'm just not my thing. But I kept getting pulled into it because I used to work, you know, on Bratz with the animated series and all the different, like the movie with Lionsgate and all these things. So I kept resisting. And then within a sequence of 3 weeks, right before the masterclass started, I had one guy friend that's a very close friend that kept saying, you got to do this masterclass. And then another friend that I don't even know that found out about what I was doing. And it was like, we need you. So he calls me and he says, we need you to do this masterclass. I'm like, why is nobody telling me what this masterclass, I don't understand what this is. Can you tell me who's going to be there, what we're doing? Like, no, we can't tell you. I'm like, well, I'm supposed to go to freaking Comic-Con that week. I'm not gonna so I was resisting massively until, again, so Yellow Brick Road, it's crazy. I had a friend that was teaching this new exercise class at Hollywood Boulevard, and I happened to park and drive up, or park and then walk up to a row of stars with no names on them on Hollywood Boulevard, and I take a picture and I put it on Facebook and I'm like, this is my star on Hollywood Boulevard, and I made a joke about it and everyone was like commenting. I'm like, look people, it's a free-for-all, come get yours, there's a ton. I was just messing around. And so take the class, come back, and I get all these calls from people saying you gotta do a master class. I'm like, fine, let me look at the application. So I look at the application and the theme was A Star Is Born. And I'm like, holy shit, that's creepy, because I just came from Hollywood Boulevard and I said, this is my star on Hollywood Boulevard. And here's the masterclass application. I'm like, okay, that's a clear sign. Thanks, universe.
Well, when the movie comes out, do you have that star? Is that the date?
Not yet, but I called it. Exactly. So I ended up doing the masterclass. So I went to the interview and ended up being there for 2.5 hours. It was supposed to be an hour, but they were chatting and they were at the end, they were can you please tell us that you're going to commit to this? And I said, can you tell me what this is exactly? Because I'm supposed to go to Comic-Con that same week. And they're like, well, we can't really tell you, but the only thing we can tell you is that it's going to be really big and there's really big A-listers and big people involved. And you're gonna meet with them. And we only pick 26 people, and only 12 people from LA and 14 people from Tel Aviv. So every year they switch between Tel Aviv and LA. And again, this was the last year. So it was the golden ticket of golden tickets beyond. So yeah, so at the end they're like, okay, so we're gonna see you on Sunday, right? When the Tel Aviv contingent comes in at the hotel, right? And I'm like, okay, yeah, I guess. They suckered me into it. I was like, yeah, I don't know about this. I'm analytical, so I need to know everything in advance and strategize. I can't just be this, whatever this is, it's a secret. Okay. Yeah, but literally, I think when I saw the itinerary, I almost fell out of the chair. I was like, I almost said no to this. Holy shit. This is awesome. Yeah, so it's amazing. So,
sounds like for you, a clue that you should do something is when you start resisting.
Well, this is the thing. So there's twofold here, which I think most people have issues with. It's the thing of you plan things and God laughs because you plan. And then there's the, universe wants you to do X, Y, Z, and I resist. And actually this happened with Whiz Girls Academy too, which I'll tell you next. But so I showed up and I was like, oh my God, we met with Chuck Lorre and the president of Warner Brothers and Ben Silverman and the head of this on the first day, right? And so it was literally every day for a week we did this, And it was amazing because we talked about projects and they heard about us and what we're doing. And it was just really, really cool experience.
That's amazing.
So yeah, so after, so between that, so and then I've been in touch with some of those people and we've been messing around like who should play me in this movie. And we've had a lot of different people fly around. But initially I said Penelope Cruz, and then a friend of mine was like, no, it's got to be Anne Hathaway. And I was like, no, I don't think so. I mean, I love her, but I don't know. And then someone said it should be Nazanin Boniadi because she's Persian and we're very similar. And then I met her and I told her she was going to play me, which was really funny. I have a picture on Instagram if you look at my Instagram. Yeah. And but recently, since my nickname is the Wonder Woman of Tech, I keep getting Gal Gadot. So we'll see.
There you go.
I'm being open.
Well, I'm curious to see who is going to be as well, but I believe it's going to happen. So I'm excited. So you want, where would you like to go next in this conversation?
So I think the resistance thing I was talking about with Whiz Girls Academy. So now the same year in 2011, we're moving different versions of beta on the gaming side, and I'm getting pulled into like different campaigns, like the new re-election campaign for Tech for Obama. So I'm speaking there, I'm getting pulled in to speak to a lot of different crowds. And every single time, like a bunch of people come up to me and they say, you got to teach my kids how to code. And I'm like, yeah, no, I'm good. Like I'm bootstrapping a tech startup. I don't have time for another thing. And they're like, no, but you understand the kid space, you're a coder, you get this, like, come on, you got to do this. And I was like, no, I'm good. So this went on for a couple weeks up until I was at USC, literally crossing the street on Hoover and like 36. And this woman sees me and she says, what is this bag you're carrying? And I said, oh, it's a bag for the show on PBS that Gina Davis was promoting. And so she starts telling me how she teaches here at USC and she has a daughter that's 11 and she's really into soccer. I said, that's great. And she's like, well, yeah, soccer is really boyish. I'm like, no, soccer is cool. It's a cool thing. And she's like, she literally takes me by the collar and in the middle of the street and she says, my daughter loves computers, but she doesn't know what to do with them. You need to teach her how to code this summer. And I was like, oh my God, okay.
Is this your life every day or are you just giving us the highlights?
Well, see, the thing is, like, I'm really, I guess, present. Like, I know what I need to do. Sometimes, like I said, plan things and God laughs, which is kind of like this hamster wheel cycle, which is kind of funny.
For sure.
But I'm also
my grandmother used to say that to me all the time. So
but it's also the thing where it's like, you know, I feel like everyone has a superpower and a mission on this planet. And when you find what it is, it's not like it's handed on a silver platter, but it's like something that's super important that you need to like follow. Right. And that's why I call it being on the tech yellow brick road, because there's always signs and messages. And every time you feel like you're not in this right place or whatever that is, something will happen that will lead you to that place. Like I resisted the whole White House thing, or even like, yeah, the White House was like, teach kids how to code. I was like, no, I'm good. Like you guys can find, there's all these other coding programs, you know, you could go to them. Like
someone else can do this.
Yeah. But then when I did the research and it kept coming up, and up until this woman literally grabbed me by the collar and shook me, I was like, okay, white flag. Like I got to research this and figure this out. And as a research person, it was easy because it was like, all right, I'm gonna like get a bunch of parents and ask them, you know, like Survey Monkey, like, hey, what do you think about these coding programs? What's going on? And then the kids I was asking as well. And I was getting, we're not getting real coding, it's scratch. I was getting, it's kind of babyish, like these tech camps are like just babysitting, like it's not really anything. And from what I know, kids want to learn and they want to do the real thing. So this time, if you give them an iPad or a Leap Pad, they'll grab the iPad, but the Leap Pad is babyish, right? So I was like, okay, so there's something I could provide here, value. So I'm like, okay, we're going to teach real coding. I partnered with General Assembly and we took their curriculum. So we teach real coding, but it's project-based learning and it's gamified. So it's really fun and different. And then I was like, okay, for the hackathons, we can't just have these kids sitting for like 10 hours for the day. Like that's not going to work. So we're going to learn how to meditate. It's going to be part of my healthy balanced lifestyle program for the brand on the gaming side. We're going to do fitness. We're going to do healthy eating. We're going to learn about being entrepreneurs. Like we're going to do all this different stuff. And then at the end of the day, they're going to pitch like Shark Tank style.
Okay.
And that literally like flew like it just took off like wild. I mean, we did our first hackathon. I think, I don't know if you were there, but Joe was definitely there. Yeah. The first hackathon at Cross Campus that we were live on Google Hangout with the White House.
Yeah, my brother was there. I wasn't there.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's how it started. So that's literally what I've been doing ever since Whiz Girls Academy. We started out doing summer camps, after school programs, coding camps, all that stuff. Now I've been doing mostly hackathons in person, but since the shift and what's happening now with, you know, the present time that we live in, we've been shifting to online. So I'm planning to launch an online intro session next Tuesday and then a full on 4-week program.
So have you, this is near and dear to my heart, because that's a lot of what I've had to try and work out is how, you know, how to do, one of the things I do is I teach a course in negotiation skills, and it's really fun doing that live with people, and there's a lot of interaction, and I'm adapting it to Zoom, but I'm, you know, it's like, oh, I'm going to use the breakout room, but it's awkward, right, to try and figure out how to do that. There's a, if you've got multiple breakout rooms, how do you do that? You know what I'm saying? Like you want.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, like, I was focused on kids initially. I'm like, I'm being open to all ages, but I'm focused on the 8 to 13 demographic. And from what I know, I can't have them more than an hour on Zoom a day. So I was like, normally when I do it in person, like when we did after school programs, we would do like 2 hours, you know, and we did a little like snack break in between and like workout break or whatever. But now it's like, okay, I got to do like 1 hour and then we'll come back the next day and we'll do 1 hour. So we'll, it's a consistent. And the thing with coding is like, you got to keep practicing. It's like learning a foreign language. So if I lose, I can't just do once a week. Like I got to constantly be in their heads about this stuff.
So you're doing an hour a day for how long?
For 4 weeks.
Okay. That's quite a commitment, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, they're going to learn HTML and CSS, and then in the end, they're going to pitch as well.
Well, I meant for you more than them.
Oh, well, yeah. Yes and no. I mean, it's an hour of my day, so it's not that big of a deal. I can work meetings and things around it, so okay. Yeah.
So have you worked out how you're going to adapt your style to doing this virtually?
I haven't really thought about it, because I feel like it wouldn't be that much different than being in person. Cause like I've taken classes, you know, virtually or done stuff. So I feel like it could be easy flow. I mean, I don't know. I'll let you know how it goes, but
yeah, totally, really curious. I'm generally trying to figure out how to solve the problem.
Yeah, no, but I'm thinking like, cause I know kids' attention spans are like not too much. So I'm like, okay, I know I got to do interactive things with them throughout that hour, not just teaching them. So that's another thing. As well. Sure.
But yeah. My sense about you is that you're very intuitive and you get a sense of people's energy level and you adapt based upon what the situation calls for.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
So doing it virtually, I mean, it helps, like, you know, like I bet if I interviewed you in person, I just have a whole different feeling. You're very expressive. So I get a lot from looking at, you know, your face, but
right. Still,
like, you don't get the whole energy on Zoom that you do in person, I'm thinking.
Yeah, of course. That's a different story, I think, doing that. And actually, that's another thing. Like, so I've been asked to do a show or a podcast, and this keeps coming up. So I was like, okay, I think I need to start this now that I have a little bit more time. Because I feel like most of our times have been stuck in traffic, driving around LA, getting to meetings or whatever that is. So now we don't have to worry about that time anymore. We just get on. Again, it's not the same energy, but it's at least we're saving some time.
Yeah. Well, I think you'd be awesome hosting your own podcast. What are you thinking about hosting?
Like I think it's a cross between, from what I've heard and people, because you know, I've been talking about my story for a while. Something like Gary Vee does, you know, how he does that, but yeah. with my story and like STEM focused and gaming, so a little bit of a twist.
And is your audience, like, what age is your audience? Everything or?
I think. So that's an interesting question, because I've spoken a ton, and I spoke at USC, and this 60-year-old plus man, he was 60-something, because I remember he ran up to me and he goes, your story inspired me so much, and I'm 60-something. And I said, whoa, like, you're not my demographic. Like, I want to inspire the next generation of kids to be excited, obviously, like, more girls and boys to be excited about STEM and tech and everything. So that's like 8 to 13, right? But then with the hackathons, we've done that age. We've done high school. We've done, I used to teach at USC in the engineering school. So like I've had a wide range of ages, and I feel like every age wants inspiration or direction or like, you know, something. So I'm going to keep it open. I don't want to just limit it.
Yeah. Well, my, you know, my sense of you is that if you do something that you enjoy and you're really interested in, your audience will find you. So don't do any conversations you're bored with.
Yeah, no. I was thinking about doing conversations of people that have, you know, crossed my path on the Yellow Brick Road to start, and then other people, and then kind of like a Gary V-ish type of thing, because I feel like he's great, but he yells too much. And it's like, I don't know, people don't want to hear yelling. Some, I think he's awesome and I love him dearly, but I feel like
people don't want to hear yelling of Gary V.
Yeah, exactly. And the other thing is there's not a lot of females entrepreneurs, totally, tech people, you know, that are kind of vocal about things, or not, you know, there's not many of us. So
my daughters just missed the window for your, that's one of the things I was looking for when my daughters were younger. My older daughter's a journalist, but my younger daughter
is
more into technology, and I tried to give her, but she didn't have female role models. I mean, I remember I took my girls to the Women's World Cup in the Rose Bowl. I particularly liked soccer or whatever, but
yeah,
I wanted them, like, I'm passionate about sports, and I wanted them, yeah, to, you know, girls can do
that's anything. Really cool.
Yeah. But so like, I definitely, again, like my kids are late 20s, early 30s. So at this point, they don't want to hear what dad has to say so much. But for people that have young daughters, like they're looking for role models. So, I mean, I'm sure you experienced that quite a bit already.
Well, that's the thing. That's why I started this whole thing, is because I kept getting, we don't have enough positive role models in the media, in real time, you know, all that.
Yeah. For sure. So that's great. So when are you doing your first workshop?
So we're doing the intro session on Tuesday, the 7th. And then I have an Eventbrite, if you want me to send you a link. And then we're going to start, like, I want to say a week after, because I want to vet who's like really serious about moving forward and, like, you know, all that jazz.
Oh, that's terrific.
Yeah.
So I want to shift a little bit to get your ideas about the current situation, what we can do to keep moving forward. I was going to say keep a positive attitude, but I don't know if so much we need a positive attitude as much as a way forward to what we can do that's productive.
So I think, I mean, people always ask me, like, what's going on? How am I doing? And I'm like, look, I normally work from home, so it's not that much different. I miss going to the gym and that kind of thing, but like, it's one of those things where I said earlier, I feel like everyone has like a superpower, or like everyone has a gift, and they need to find what that is. And I think now is the time to step up and like step into their powers and like move forward with it. And whatever that is, like, I can't tell you what it is, because it took me a while to figure out what mine was, right? Even though I had all the clues kind of in my face. But I really believe that. And I think it's important to move forward, obviously positively, but also like take this time now. Like I still go to the library. I got a ton of books, and I'm like, oh good. Like, I don't need to go return them now. I have more time to read. Right. So I'm doing that. I'm like listening to more podcasts myself, and like some spiritual, some entrepreneurial, you know, different ones. I'm doing all these different things that I normally wouldn't have time to do, so that I can keep building and keep, you know, figuring out what my vision is for the next episode, right?
Yeah. Well, what I'm gleaning, and tell me if I'm putting words in your mouth, is spend this time to find what you're passionate about and do that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
I think it's super important.
Totally.
And I think when you're passionate about something, you don't know when the time flies. Like, you'll do anything to make it happen, and you don't worry about the money so much when you start out. And I know, again, we're all going through a lot of changing times, and people are worrying about financial things and all these different things, but I truly believe that everyone has a purpose and a mission, and when you are super passionate about first finding out what that is and then sharing it with the world, like everything falls into place. And the universe will make things happen for you, even if you resist, right? Like, even if you're like, no, I don't know. You get pushed into XYZ, right? There was so many times I told you where I was like, I don't know about this. No, I don't think so. But it turned out to be like amazing beyond my dreams of like even imagining, right?
Totally. So is there some way which this situation, and I call it the situation kind of like in Israel, the matzav, you know,
it's
a situation that we're dealing with more than, anything we've got control over. But do you feel like it's changed you in any way?
Well, I mean, it's like, I feel like the world has changed, right? It's not just us in LA, it's the entire world has changed.
For sure.
So I think everybody's going through like an awakening process. And I think it's going to be like different times moving forward. It's definitely not going to be normal, whatever normal is for people anymore.
Normal.
Right?
Normal.
So, I mean, I feel like, and again, I strongly believe this is a time for everyone to step up into their superpowers and like find out what that is and just keep working at it. And it's like building a house, right? It's like, and like I say that to the kids too, or building wireframes for a website or an app. Like, it's the same thing. Like, you got it one step at a time, one brick at a time. Like, it takes one day at a time to make it work and figure out what the next steps are. And sometimes you get lost in the hamster wheel, you know, but it's okay, because you know you have a purpose and a mission and you keep coming back to it.
Totally. One of the things I'm grappling with, I really can't come up with an answer. Maybe you've got a couple of pebbles on the road for me to follow. I think that as a business person, one of the things that, you know, that the economy in general, but business people in particular, we didn't assess the risk very well. If you look at how, you know, tight our supply lines are and you know, like one of the things I always talk about is how back in the day, when my grandparents' time, when you could burn your mortgage was something to be celebrated. And now anyone who's burning their mortgage is going to re-leverage it to buy another property, which is good. But we hadn't accounted for risk. And you see how fragile it all is. You know, you have all these people. I know people who were very successful, I know, a month ago. And now they're trying to figure out how to keep their businesses going, because they just couldn't have that level of risk. Now, you know, maybe there is no way to plan for it, but I wonder if there isn't a certain amount of risk we've taken for granted that we need to reassess.
Look, I think in general, we've taken a lot of things for granted. You know, people are like, oh, we miss NBA, we miss, you know, soccer, whatever. And it's like, look, you had that, right? You had all of those things, but everyone was so busy and no time for anything and just so busy. I need to do this. I need to do blah, blah, blah. It was like overload. I feel like it was serious overload. So now we're getting to, first of all, again, I go back to, I think it's a great awakening and a lot of people really, you know, stepping into who they're meant to be for real in this time. But also it's what really matters, right? And what really mattered last month definitely doesn't matter now, right? Because we're kind of limited in the things that we can do kind of outside of the house, right? We have to social distance and we have to keep, you know, making sure everyone's safe and whatever. Can't go to the beach, which really sucks.
Totally.
But I think there's a purpose for it. And I feel like when we come out on the other side, we're going to be way bigger, way stronger, and way more resourceful. And again, like I said earlier, I think it's that whole thing that I keep hearing about, the Great Depression and all these people. There were so many entrepreneurs and millionaires and people that like thrived through it because they were super focused on their passions or what they wanted to do to make a difference in the world. And I think we're literally getting pushed into that. The universe wants that right now.
You're absolutely right. Let's get going. You've inspired me. All right. Let's make it happen. So, anything you want to leave the audience with?
Great question. I'm always open for questions. So if you guys want to follow me on Instagram or any of the social medias, I'm happy to reach out back and, you know, check out the workshops coming up.
Beautiful. Well, I've really enjoyed this conversation. I'm so glad that you agreed to do this, and it's been really fun.
Thank you so much for having me, and thanks for the time.
My pleasure, and I'm looking forward to your upcoming podcast. I'll have to definitely check that out.
Yeah, well, stay tuned for that. I got to figure it out with your brother.
All right, that sounds good. Thank you.
All right.
Some late breaking news. Since we recorded the interview, Shirin has announced the next Whiz Girls Academy. The intro session is very soon, Tuesday, April 7th from 3 to 4 p.m. Pacific time. As you can see on this flyer, it's on Eventbrite. I will share the URL in the show notes. It's kind of a long URL, so you can also get to it by searching through Eventbrite for Whiz Girls. In this event, the young folks are going to learn about the basics about HTML, CSS, UI, UX, and they're going to build a wireframe for a website or an app. They need to have a laptop, Wi-Fi access, charger, and then some other writing materials. If you don't understand what any of that is, but you want your little ones to learn what they are, you don't need to know. What you want to know is that if they learn how to take this event, they're going to actually learn something useful and come out of it knowing how to do some practical things on their computer. So I hope you enjoyed this interview as much as I did. And be sure to pass this along to anyone that you think would be eligible. So have a great day, and we will see you next time.